to be here early in the morning. I attended some of the conference yesterday and the day before, and really was kind of like, you know, challenged by the variety of topics, realizing that there is almost nobody from my discipline of film studies here. And I was saying, oh my God, like, you know, how can I, what can I do to really make contact with the audience? Kind of yesterday I had an epiphany and I said, like, you know, I would change my talk to kind of like, you know, get closer to the people who are speaking here. So on the one hand, I decided to make adjustments and actually talk more about Mediterranean things, because one thing which is not in the introduction, but of course I didn't know which way it is going to go, is that I started my development as a professor of film studies first with lots of writing on the cinema of the Balkan region. So I know quite well the cinemas around the Mediterranean countries, mainly the cinemas of Turkey, Yugoslavia, kind of like, you know, this western part of, eastern part of the Mediterranean. So I thought to connect with the audience, like, you know, I will talk a little bit more on Mediterranean issues. And then the other thing is, I had shortage of images, and because I'm film studies professor, I need images to come with, like, you know, anything I do, I cannot live with. And this is why I studied philosophy, but I escaped into film studies, because we need images. So I also decided to structure my presentation around images, and it will be improvised, but I hope it will work. So it is not rehearsed, and it is not something I have given, like, you know, so I changed quite substantially from what I intended to do at the beginning, like, you know, which would be much heavier on talking. In this instance, it's going to be heavier on images, but I hope nice images, yes. This one is taken by me. And I want to start with an anecdote. So this table was the table that I sat at in the month of June this year during a visit to the island of Cyprus, which happens to be at the very end of the East Mediterranean, obviously. It was my first visit to Cyprus, and it was extremely interesting visit for me. I really want to go back to this island again, and my desire to go back to this island was really formed during this lunch. So I was sitting at the place from where I've taken the photograph, and my friend, whose phone you see here on the table, who is a Cypriot, young Cypriot professor of architecture, was sitting on the other hand, and we had just visited a Turkish hammam in the Greek part of Nicosia. This was in the capital Nicosia, and I was telling her how amazing I find that even though Cyprus has been now divided for several decades, still in the Greek part of Cyprus I see so many elements of Turkish life which have not been obliterated. The very fact that we visited the hammam, which is a completely Turkish tradition, was speaking to this. Or the earlier in the day I had breakfast with lahmacun, which is a typical Turkish kind of like a variety of pizza, which not even the name was changed. So, like, you know, we were on the Greek side, Turkish presence was there. But one thing which you cannot see in this picture is that probably just a few steps from where we were sitting was the wall dividing Nicosia into two parts. The wall, of course, does not look like the Berlin Wall, which I remember very well from my childhood and youth. But it is still there. At places, the wall is actually stuck of sacks. At some places it is just improvised, like, you know, various thin pieces of tin which have been put together. And life functions up until the very wall. You can see people sitting in cafes in the shadow of the wall. You could see people kind of like, you know, totally functioning. Yet it is a wall, and the city is divided and has this leery, empty feeling of an abandoned place at moments, especially the closer you get to the wall. And in spite it is extremely beautiful and the Mediterranean table was perfect, it gave me somehow a feeling of things to come. I really hate to say this, but kind of like, you know, it's some sort of post-conflict divisions where you have no desire, no interest in the other, because the conversation which my friend and I had around this table was the following. So I say, it was so interesting to be in Nicosia and in Cyprus this time, but please tell me, can the Turks or from the other side cross into here, can they probably eat with us? And she says, yes, of course they can cross. Then I say, can you cross on the other side and go into the Turkish part? And she says, yes, of course I can cross. Have you ever crossed? No, I have never crossed. She's 35 years old. Do you have interest in crossing? No, I have no interest in crossing whatsoever. So kind of this interesting feeling of, in this case, illustrated by the existence of the wall, was kind of like, you know, very vivid reminder that my feeling is really that things are going this way, of like, you know, a situation where we have divided, where everybody have occupied their space, and there is no interest in crossing into each other's territory. And this is what triggers some thoughts further into what I want to say. So the Mediterranean table looked fantastic, but it was missing in togetherness. So continuing the conversation with Poppy from that day, we were talking about many places and about experiencing these places. She had defended a doctoral thesis the year before at King's College in London in architecture. Her thesis was about the architectural experiencing of Casa Malaparte. So now, because many of you are Mediterraneanists, probably, I don't know, you're familiar with Casa Malaparte on the island of Capri, which is built after sketches by Curzio Malaparte, who is obviously much better known as a writer, but who was also interested in architecture, and created this amazing house, which is on the island. Those of you who have seen the film Le Mépris by Jean-Luc Godard probably will remember famous scenes with Brigitte Bardot and I think, was it Belmondo is in this film? Yes. Michel Piccoli, I'm sorry, and Michel Piccoli in on the staircase of this house. But Poppy's thesis had not been about the film, even though she was mentioning in the thesis about the film, but mainly about traveling to Capri. So she was developing an idea that in the Mediterranean, architecture is not just in the architectural spaces themselves, but also in your experiencing of the spaces. That you can travel and experience the space, and this is what she had written about, architecture as experiencing certain places. So she had written a thesis about experiencing Casa Malaparte in Capri, but we were sitting in Cyprus, I asked her if she has ever visited the city of Famagusta, which is on the island of Cyprus. It is a city which is probably about 1 hour drive from Nicosia. Poppy did have a car and we drove around many places in Cyprus, but she said that no, she has never gone to Famagusta, because Famagusta is a city which is precisely on the border between the Turkish and Greek parts of Cyprus. It is known for some amazing architectural sites, like this Lala Pasha Mustafa Mosque in Famagusta, which is you can see it is a mosque, but at the same time it has many traces of European, Venetian heritage and so on. And Famagusta is a city which has several other monuments of this type, all abandoned. Famagusta today is a ghost city because it was a thriving seaside spa town when the invasion from Turkey happened in 1974. and all the businesses were abandoned, and almost all people left. From a population of about 200,000, to date is less than 5,000 people that live in Famagusta. So if you go on the internet, for example, you can see drone footage of a complete ghost city where the footage is taken from the air, and you see, like, you know, how all the hotels are still there, how all these establishments and how all these fantastic architectural monuments are there, but they're not maintained, and people only go really to experience a ghost city. So I'm comparing this, these two images again to reiterate this feeling that I was left with after the visit to Cyprus, and as I say, our return. Because on the one hand, we have somebody who is willing to travel and experience a house that is not really inhabited today and very rarely visited, but validate the experience of going and traveling through space to reach an architectural monument, whereas a monument that is much nearer to the place where this person lives is somehow left out of her semantic space. And I see this quite a bit in the region of the Mediterranean, this part that I know, and this is what I'd like to talk about, again, through images, mainly because my work is in film studies, and obviously listening to presentations yesterday, quite a few images flocked into my mind. I thought, sitting in the room yesterday, quite a bit about various islands, because the Mediterranean, some of you spoke about experiences or various aspects of your studies are related to islands. So again, I remembered how my experience of the Mediterranean took shape while sitting on a beach on the southern side of the island of Crete in Greece, which is again a typical Mediterranean island. We were sitting and looking into the sea, and I asked my friend, what is it if we go directly into the sea, where will we get on the other side? And my friend said, where we are sitting, if we take a boat, we will get into Egypt. My friend lives in Britain, I live in Britain myself, so, like, you know, I circulate mainly in the Western world and in Asia, as you can see. But kind of like, you know, this feeling that we were so close to the Arab world was kind of like, you know, giving me completely different experience of space and geography and destinations. She said that Greek fighters after the end of World War II were using the south side of Cyprus to land on, to get on little boats with which they traveled to Egypt to escape the civil war in Greece, and many of them landed in Egypt and kind of organized resistance from there. In many respects, these kind of, like, you know, peaceful and beautiful places remind me to what you may have seen are the green fields of the Auschwitz concentration camp, which are appearing in the film of Claude Lanzmann about the concentration camp, showing how today you have a completely peaceful and beautiful environment where nature has come back to take toll. But these are places which really have seen quite a bit of conflict and separation. So I'd like to come to talking about what I call watching across borders and go back in time a little bit. I do realize that all this started for me quite personally. I was a relatively new emigre. I had emigrated just a few years ago. I'm a typical product of post-1989 migration. I was living in the States at that time, and it roughly coincided with the time when my son was born, so I was a young mother and had a baby. Was watching on television the footage from the Bosnian War, so looking something like this. Villages were burning in Bosnia. I remember there was footage of a father who was embracing his dead baby, and obviously, like, you know, it was a very visceral experience for me because, as I said, I was a young mother at this time. And seeing these villages burning in Bosnia. Now, Bosnia is relatively close to where I'm from. I'm from the city, I'm from the capital of Bulgaria, from Sofia. It is, of course, like, you know, some villages burn somewhere else, kind of like, you know, we see it all the time. But somehow, maybe because I was experiencing these images in the context of Texas, like totally displaced somewhere else, it kind of struck a chord with me, because I said that, yes, this may be in Bosnia, and I'm from a different country, which is not affected by conflict, nothing is burning in my own country, but oh my God, it just looks exactly the same. The way these burning villages look in Bosnia, it could absolutely easily be Bulgarian villages burning in Bulgaria, in the mountains, which I knew so well. This is the moment when I did realize that I cannot function as an academic by only exploring issues that I know all too well. That all my exploration is always going to be relational to things which actually interest me and touch me. I recently had exactly the same experience when I was visiting. I mentioned to some of you that I was visiting the Basque country in September, and I don't know how I found myself on some interesting, very isolated bridge, which was now closed. It was not possible to access the bridge. It was a bridge which was crossing the river between Irun and whatever is on the other side. I cannot do Hendaya, yes, in France. At the very beginning of the bridge, there was some poster showing images from the time of the Spanish Civil War, with lots of refugees that have crossed the river, and kind of like, you know, still looking to the place where they had come from, where there was fire. So kind of like, I'm not displaying an image of this here, but I remember that I went online and I searched for images because I really needed to see these images, and it was happening exactly at the same. So I saw these images from the 1930s at the time. When the television was showing permanently images from the Rohingya crisis, like, you know, at that time it was kind of like, you know, people were crossing to Bangladesh, and all we were seeing were, like, you know, images again taken across the water to burning villages. So yes, of course, in one case it may be Irun, today it may be Rohingya. So I do not want to limit what we're able to say. To, like, you know, can we only speak about Spain, and can we only speak about the country that we know, or probably what we see, it looks the same. So by the association that it looks the same, perhaps there are many things that we're able to say, even if we do not know exactly the configuration. So looking the same for me is actually the basis of watching across borders, which I propagate. So starting with these realizations that when things look the same, it actually probably enables us to say more about things. Like, you know, so starting from the representation, we can go deeper. And that, obviously, working in film and media studies, I'm always limited to working with representation. Several years later, I published a monograph called Cinema Flames, Balkan Film, Culture and the Media. Now it is quite a few years back. Of course, I have done many other books since. But this was for me a formative book because it gave me opportunity for several important realizations that have stayed with me since. First, the choice of our research question is always defined by our personal politics. Now, this is important for me to state, like, you know, maybe when I say it, you may say, yes, it is obvious to me, but my feeling is that in academia, many people do not really realize that what we research is actually always informed by some situation in our lives that gives us certain discomfort and prompts us to go and investigate, even if it is something like, you know, which may be many years ago or taking place back in history or taking place in some remote part of the world. There is always certain personal discomfort that drives you to choose to research or like, you know, do more work in this direction. There is something which we have to ask ourselves, but why is it, what is it that makes me to want to go and research this thing? Then, of course, something which I have done myself, and I always try to acknowledge which is the moment that actually made me to be drawn or interested in researching something, like the moment with the Mediterranean lunch with this young woman that has now given trigger to many thoughts that I have about the place at the moment. So the position of the researcher needs to be written in, and the discomforts need to be acknowledged, in my opinion. This is what I always tell my PhD students, and I see that young scholars very often try to hide, to kind of like, you know, try to remove themselves from what they study. But I do believe that there is a way to write yourself, and you have to acknowledge that you cannot be outside of what you're doing. You are inside, and you have to find a way it is okay to write yourself in. Then we have choice what to make pronouncements on, and I do believe that we should watch across borders, meaning trying to see beyond our immediate environment, and trying to make pronouncements not only about our immediate environment, but also trying to know about the others, and making pronouncements of this. I'll give some examples in a moment. What is the politics of watching across borders? So now, obviously, in my case, the research practice that I'm involved in involves lots of watching a film. So being a film professor, this is what I do for more than 30 years. I see at least one film a day. Before I came to Korea, I saw a number of Korean films, even though I have seen many Korean films in the past as well. But every next visit to a country, of course, prompts me to see more. So, like, you know, I saw some fantastic Buddhist themes, themed films from Korea. So I have a choice to not watch Korean films and just come to Korea and deliver the knowledge that I have, or I have the choice to watch across borders and experience the culture that I'm going to immerse myself into. I'm not going to be talking about the Korean films today, but this watching across borders already informs the way in which I probably can communicate with people, and what do I see. So what do I see when I come to the country? The moment I see the mountains opposite the university here, I already have images from these certain films, and who do I talk to is also informed by this. Then another thing I want to say is that I don't really base this on impressions from yesterday, especially because I could not attend the whole day, but very often I go to conferences where I see people as if contributing to a conference on area studies, or kind of, you know, covering some wider area or interdisciplinary area, but at the same time, quite a few presentations only dwell in the national, only in one nation, and the observations, so people feel more secure to base their observations on one nation. I personally always propagate, let's try to make our observations transnational, to make them have more validity. So I'm thinking of Mona's presentation yesterday, for example, who provided some explanation why she is basing her work on Egypt. Yes, of course, you're more comfortable with observing your own nation, but ultimately, you also try to have validity beyond this nation and make your observations transnational. And I am known to have propagated in cinema studies transnational mode of work, because obviously in film, especially where we want to study the context and the production distribution context, film is a transnational art, so it is very important for us. Methodological clarity is an increased awareness of what informs your choices. So when we speak about methodology, like, you know, what choices do we make on approaching the material? Ultimately, in understanding the methodology, I believe if we are able to to see what are the considerations that inform our choices in approaching the material in a certain way. This is really where we get to the clarity. And again, I want to repeat this, that the approach is informed always by certain discomfort, some disagreement that we have, probably with the way some issue is tackled, some discomfort we have of the absence of some discussion in the public space. There is always something that drives us to kind of like to have corrective aspect to our scholarship. So I'll go back to the Mediterranean now to give some examples of the thoughts that I had about Mediterranean issues. And like, I'm really pleased to know that you have Institute of Mediterranean Studies, because it's a fantastically interesting area. So for me, the Mediterranean, kind of studying his aspects related to the Mediterranean, has been recognizing that if we go back in time, we are confronted with numerous alternative geographies. Geographies that are completely different to the configurations that we have today. Because today, certainly, the geopolitical configurations are of one type. And when we go back in history, especially in the area of the Mediterranean, we discover these alternative geographies. Coming from Bulgaria, which is near Greece and Turkey, I know and I have written about the interest of all these countries to relate to the West somehow. So, you know, Turkey is struggling to get accepted into the European community. Greece is always wants to be considered as the cradle of West European civilization. Every country in this region kind of like, you know, evolves mainly around the dynamics of Southeast and West, mainly in Europe. So like, you know, the relationship is mainly to the West. Reading books from past times, for example, this is one extremely interesting book which has been filmed a number of times by migrant Romanian writer Panaiti Strati, reveals completely different geography, and I thought to display this map here about showing the geography of the Levant, because it shows protagonists that are traveling in completely different spaces than the spaces that have validity today. The protagonists of Panaiti Strati, they may be born in what is Romania today, but they travel to Damascus, they travel to Lebanon, to Aleppo. All these cities are like, you know, some thriving cities. Just think of what is Aleppo today. Historically, Aleppo is kind of like, you know, some extremely beautiful, attractive destination for their travels. Traveling to Anatolia, to various Greek destinations, names of cities which are outside of the map somehow. Of course, they are on the map, but they are not. They don't have the semantic importance that they have in the past. This is really a fantastic aspect of kind of like, you know, if we engage in these regional studies, to have a completely different take on the human geographies of the past. There was a book which fascinated me some years ago by Charles King called The Black Sea, again a historical treatise, which was showing different aspects of how you can study cultural history just around the Black Sea region. There is writing about the Marmara Sea, which is kind of like, you know, enclosed within the Aegean, of course, is another possible space. And those of you who work on the Western Mediterranean, you can come up with other examples. But alternative geographies takes us to some other places and makes us to see the different, now forgotten aspects of these dimensions. Again, around the Mediterranean, my thinking goes into the trajectories of multiculturalism. And of course, multiculturalism is an important aspect of what I see when watching across borders. Specifically, the Mediterranean area is full of these trajectories of multiculturalism. So I see that, again, I will give examples from territory that I'm best familiar with, but I hope to hear some examples from your side, and again, a burning city in this instance is this is a picture from 1922, the Great Fire of Smyrna. Smyrna is called today Izmir in Turkey. This is on the Asian side of the Aegean Sea. Izmir was one of the biggest. Smyrna was one of the biggest Greek cities what was the Ottoman Empire. So the Ottoman Empire dissolved at the end of 19th century and beginning of 20th century, and Atatürk and the Young Turk movement conducted the revolution after 1920. And one of the things which happened was the taking over of the city of Izmir. There had been a great exchange of populations, so these territories had been given to Turkey. These are treaties that had taken place already at the end of 19th century, but still Smyrna had a substantial Greek population, so the Turks came and by force took this territory. The attack on Smyrna and other territories on the Asian side resulted in the migration of more than 2 million Greeks into the European part of Greece within less than a year, which even until today is referred to in Greece as the Great Catastrophe, the Megali Catastrophe. And it's connected with this fire. Of course, again, a number of films have been made and so on. Now, I have recently visited a few years ago the city of Izmir. My Turkish friends who live there have heard that there has been such a thing in the past, but of course they have to come live there recently. So, historical consciousness is usually not part of the thinking of people who live there today. And as you'll see in another example that I'll give in a moment. And I was taken, so it was very interesting because from Izmir I was taken to visit the ancient city of Ephesus, which always Troy is not very far from there, so all these Greek antiquity places are actually in the vicinity of Izmir. And then we also went to see a village, which is now extremely beautifully restored, where the Greek houses that have been abandoned for many years, now the younger generation of Turks have restored them to their former architectural value, and it is a place that people love to visit. So it is a syncretic example of how the new culture builds on the old, and even though it starts with the conflict, life goes on. The colleague who mentioned a few days, 2 days ago, the Julia Roberts film Eat, Pray, Love, inspired me to say here eat and love. But obviously we have a number of other ways to trace the trajectories of multiculturalism. This is again another narrative of displaced Greeks. Obviously they have lots of nostalgia in their culture about the displacement from what is the territory of Turkey today. This blockbuster film, which maybe Yunji, you should use it for your Mediterranean course. This is really a very important film, A Touch of Spice, which talks about the displacement of a Greek family from their very convivial existence in Istanbul, this time in the 1950s, and then the children who loved each other come together many years later again in Istanbul through love and food. So these kind of narratives trace the trajectories of multiculturalism. Then another aspect of what I see in the Mediterranean region, now a little bit expanding further to the west, is the recognition. Again, I see it in cinema mainly because I'm exposed to cinematic texts. I see these trajectories of multiculturalism translated into matters that tackle the cultural memory of the region. I want to mention this extremely important film, which is by famous Egyptian director Youssef Shahin from the 90s, Almasr Destiny, which is set in 12th century Andalusia during the times of Arab Caliphate. talks about the life of philosopher Averroes, shows the really extremely rich, very vivid, kind of completely different set of configurations of multicultural, multi-religious encounters. And of course, I can quote a number of other films that show the same way. So like I have chosen just to give one example as to not overwhelm, but I see in film this layering of cultural memory through the trajectories of multiculturalism very well developed. In recent years, now I cannot really judge because people here come from different countries, but I usually talk to people who are based in the West. Everybody knows Game of Thrones, for example, as the very interesting kind of like, you know, historical fantasy film. But in certain parts around the Mediterranean, I have observed that the Magnificent Century, the Turkish series, who knows about the Magnificent Century here? Because I realized that, okay, yeah, so I noticed that in other countries, actually, the Magnificent Century has been the most important TV product. Of course, TV series and films, it all depends pretty much on the distribution arrangements. Where will a film travel to be seen? It is not so much about what the actual film is about, like, you know, the quality of the film. So, of course, we don't imagine that we see the best films. Many of the best films, we never get to see them because it is not about the film itself. It is about if it goes into proper distribution. But the countries of the Eastern Mediterranean and the Arab world today have absolute influx of Turkish TV series, which are produced to very high production quality, and which are absolutely hugely popular, very similar to the phenomenon we had in the 1990s with telenovelas coming from Latin America that were absolutely kind of consumed all over the world. Today we have this with Turkish series, and specifically the Magnificent Century, which is about the age of Suleiman the Magnificent, has been consumed in all these countries very avidly. Has even led to some, on the one hand, Turkish series have led to the emancipation of emancipated behavior of women in many Arab countries. There are studies on this. And on the other hand, it is a very interesting kind of aestheticized representation of the Ottoman Empire and its politics. It has led to public protests in some of the Christian countries of the Eastern Mediterranean, such as Greece, for example, is one of the examples. Where people have protested in front of the building of the TV station that is airing this series because they were saying our ancestors have fought to emancipate us, to liberate us from the Ottomans, and now we are showing a film, like, you know, which is the most popular TV show about how great the Ottomans were. So kind of it is an interesting take on cultural memory and the circulation of cultural memory in public space. And then I want to say a few things about the population exchanges which really characterize the region, which it will overlap a little bit with something I was saying minutes ago. But this is what characterizes the Mediterranean. Lots of population exchanges, and when I say population exchanges, I mean agreed population exchanges, which have taken as a result of decisions that are made by governments. What happened to the Armenians, for example? It is a topic that is often avoided. It is very awkward. Like, you know, we know very little. There is spread of Armenians in all these countries around the Mediterranean, much farther, and so on. I would like to mention this film, We Drank the Same Water, by a Paris-based French actor, Armenian actor, Serge Avedikian, which has a very interesting scene. It shows the author of the film who travels in Turkey to the small village where his ancestors supposedly lived. It is a village not very far from Istanbul on the Marmara Sea, And it doesn't take him very long to discover remnants of the Armenian culture there, various monuments, various gravestones, which is all still there, just overgrown and neglected. And it is a typically Turkish village. So he finds the evidence of his ancestors. He finds the gravestones that he knew should be there and so on. But then he goes to the local pub and confronts the people in the pub, asking them, like, you know, have you ever noticed that there are, like, you know, traces of a previous life here? Like, you know, have you noticed that Armenians have lived here? And the men in the pub say, yes, we have noticed, kind of like, you know, we have seen some stones, but, like, you know, it's not part of us, like, you know. So Avedikian is trying to confront them, to ask them, why don't they take care of the heritage that they have found in the place where they live. He says, like, you know, these are my ancestors' gravestones. Like, you know, why don't you take care? And why? What do you do here? And they say, well, we ourselves, our families used to live in Bosnia, but, like, you know, we're displaced from Bosnia. Like, you know, we were sent to live here. So, like, you know, my grandfather has been sent to live in this village, and we don't know anything about this village, but we cannot go to our village in Bosnia, which our ancestors have lived in. And probably if we go to our village in Bosnia, we'll find the gravestones of our grandfathers exactly in the same condition as the gravestones of your grandfathers are. So it is a moment which shows that we are all together in this. So there is no one kind of agent that is doing continuous injustice to one group, but it is more kind of much more fluid relationship on when it gets to human basis. Like, you know, it is not possible to find the guilty once in the roots of all these population exchanges or displacements. Another important film from Turkey, Waiting for the Clouds, is stressing another aspect that even where we want to know, even when we have desire to know what happened, the scarcity of record is really extremely limited. It is about a woman who lives on the Black Sea coast of Turkey, who is Turkish and who in her 70s all of a sudden starts speaking in an unknown language, and people cannot understand what she's saying. And gradually it transpires that actually she speaks Greek language, which nobody locally can recognize. And we go back in her personal history to realize that when she was a child, this is when the massacres of 1920 around Smyrna happened, and she was displaced, and she saved her little brother, and then she was raised by a family in Turkey and became a Turkish woman. She finally finds her brother, who is now an old man, who has lived in Greece, has a fantastic family, has had absolutely fulfilling life, who does not recognize his sister. He does not even remember he had a sister. Now there is this Turkish woman who has appeared from out of nowhere, claiming that she is part of his life, and all her name, all her claim is staked on the existence of one old photograph which shows the family before the migration, before the separation, when they lived together. And I think I have one more slide to show with my images, again, from other aspects of what cinema shows us about the Mediterranean. More current or ongoing migrations. A project which I have worked on for quite a few years. I have already published several items, but my book is still forthcoming. Is a book about the representations of Roma in cinema. It is just a huge project because it always turns out to be much bigger than anything I can imagine. There's so many films about the Roma, but clearly the migration of the Roma is one of the aspects that certainly brings us very much to the south of Europe and around the Mediterranean. And I want to mention this fantastic film. I don't know if anybody has seen La Chaudron by great by Tony Gatliff. Tony Gatliff himself is a typically Mediterranean character because he's born in 1947 in Oran, in Algeria, and then he migrates to France, and many of his films are made in Spain. La Chaudrome is a French production, which is particularly interesting because it is a film about migration, but it is migration not only in space but also in time. And because it is extremely difficult to handle such material, it is a film with no dialogue. It is a film which only is based on the singing, the musical tradition of the Roma, starting in Rajasthan and then moving on to Egypt, Turkey, various other Mediterranean countries, to end up with the performance of this song in Spain. So this is about the migrations that are kind of like, you know, illicit migrations. And then in recent years, we have had a whole wave of films, some of which are made by European directors, but many are also made by directors based in Africa, even as far down in Africa as Senegal, for example, several of these films, which are showing the crossing of refugees through the sea. Now, those of you who are Spaniards, you probably have seen other films shown in Spain, because I can immediately think of several films that were made in Spain about these migrations. But I wanted to mention this very important film about refugees from last year by Gianfranco Rossi, Fire at Sea, which won the Berlinale Film Festival and is one of the best distributed films. But many other films we have that are tackling the plight of refugees. We have many other films that are tackling the plight of Syrian refugees, especially to the island of Lesbos now, and kind of like, you know, new narratives about the Mediterranean, where we can only see, to come back to what I was saying, we can only see these kind of narratives if we decide to watch across borders, because films are made in the different countries. And if I choose to sit, for example, only in Greece and observe what films are made in Greece, many of these narratives I cannot see as significant and important, because in a certain country only one or two films are made. But at the moment when I start watching across borders and decide to see what has been made in different Mediterranean countries, all these topics actually pop up, because you start seeing how there is interest to the topic in different countries. Now, a little bit of a jump, but I want to say a few things about politics of academia, because so what I outline now and what is interesting for me to research in the Mediterranean area. But of course, like everybody else, I am also part of academia, and I totally related to Jesus's talk the other day, kind of protesting about a number of trends. So let me add a few lines about of protest further. So beyond the things which Jesus, you observed in your talk, things which I have seen, because I also worked in senior administration at my university for as long as I lasted, for about 2 years, didn't last more than 2 years. One of the things which I see happening at university today is that actually there is a massive redistribution of resources within every university, with massive move of resources toward the sciences. And I have absolutely made it a point to say it, to say that this is happening, and we have to be making noises about this, in my opinion, because it is deeply unfair. Now, the excuse is usually that sciences get much more attention and much better funding because they also bring much more to the university. Usually they apply, like, you know, their grants are much more significant, and so on. So for the financial bottom line of the university, sciences have a much bigger importance. But at the same time, when it comes to, and like, you know, the function of the central administration of each university is to redistribute the resources which they have, I see really how massively resources are moved to the sciences, who seem to be better organized in claiming these resources, whereas humanities are not kind of not organized enough to come and claim their stake. So this is one of my concerns, is that these things are happening, which of course we see individual strands of humanities literally disappearing, because for my lifetime in academia, I have seen, for example, the near disappearance of Russian and Slavic studies, which, as somebody who comes from this strand, this is something that has nearly disappeared. 2-3 years ago, German language was declared to be an endangered discipline, and like, you know, is on life support at the moment. Like, you know, these kind of things should not have been happening, but to a very big extent is happening because of this redistribution of resources. Then interdisciplinarity. So here we are at an interdisciplinary conference. The very title of the conference is encouraging this. The very kind of the range of topics and so on. But at what cost interdisciplinarity? So wherever we go, we will see encouragement to be interdisciplinary. In my life experience in academia, however, beyond the encouragement, we cannot really function as interdisciplinary subjects. When it comes to assessment, when it comes to promotions, when it comes to any sort of kind of, like, you know, claiming your achievements in academia, interdisciplinarity becomes completely unviable. It cannot be plugged in. We cannot manage to capitalize on interdisciplinarity. So interdisciplinarity, unfortunately, to my great regret, is something that we can do in our free time, but the way academia is set up is absolutely effectively discouraging interdisciplinarity, and I thought we better be clear about this. Then, of course, impact was mentioned by Jesus the other day again, and the metrics, and you're lucky to be in the States, because where I am in Britain, metrics, impact, these are called, like, you know, this is an agenda that is really haunting us. I do not know, like, you know, many colleagues are from Spain, do you have the same assessments and so on? So again, it is an example of where the agenda is being dictated by the sciences. So not only resources are being moved to the sciences, but the very way in which we have to conduct our work is dictated, because of course our work has impact, but in much more subtle ways than we can demonstrate. And, like, you know, the ways of demonstrating this is dictated by the sciences. Like, you know, this is where all this discourse on digital humanities comes. Do we get a chance to play? So I would absolutely propagate, like, you know, we need to play in academia, because kind of otherwise we'll die. I don't know, but again, very little chance for this. I liked in Jesus' closeness talk the appeal to get closer to the subjects we study. And of course I asked immediately, like, you know, if we get closer to the subjects we study, how we maintain our objectivity, supposedly. But yes, I completely agree with the need to get closer to the object we study. Like, you know, in my, the way I translate this in my system of thinking is, yes, my right to acknowledge myself in the into the research is the way in which I can get closer. Like I can acknowledge that I relate to what I study. This is the way to realize the closeness. And as I had promised to talk about methodology, but I end up to not talk much about this. I found, like, you know, very difficult to address such disparity of disciplines here. For me, what is very important, again to reiterate, is that it is important to realize that we have choice in the methods that we use. It's important for me that we try to figure out what is it, to be honest with ourselves, what is it that informs our choices, and how our choices enrich us. So, do I have more time? I have two more slides, but I can stop here or maybe go on. Yes, okay. Okay, just, like, you know, again, addressing conversations which we had here. All right. So, in the context of this, it's difficult to be in humanities nowadays. So, for me, one of the most kind of important things is really that I personally feel that if this is the configuration, we need new formats and new politics. So kind of like, you know, so we have to do something to defend our right to play and to enter, like, you know, be politically different and, like, you know, defend new formats. So traditionally, for example, I'm speaking from position, I have produced 16 books, and every time when I go for a new project, again, like, you know, already my mind is configured, what is my next book? And then I said at some point, but why do I only need to produce books? It's boring, like, you know, let's do something. Maybe, like, you know, the time has come to produce something else. I was writing a blog for several years, and I saw it absolutely, completely not recognized in the context of my discipline. So I stopped doing it, to just discover later on that when I go internationally, many more people are telling me that they actually have been reading my blog, that they find it much more interesting, and so on. So the question on my mind is, what is our product? So for me, it has always been a book, but maybe not. So we were talking about games the other day. Maybe we can produce some games. I'm not so far advanced in my thinking about this, but I know that there are some people who think more about this. I am personally, I probably will start making documentary because I have recently been on the jury of several film festivals for documentary, and I do realize that actually I could make better documentaries than some of the things which I see. So I didn't put it here on the list, but I'm considering this. But I see that quite a few of academic colleagues have now embraced the video essay, which they usually display for free, freely available on YouTube. And literally, if you need film analysis, I can find much better film analysis on YouTube today than in some textbooks. And hopefully some of you also feel the urge to produce this kind of video material. And, like, you know, the fact that Jesus has come here with this large backpack containing gear to film people also speaks to this. How many of you are writing blogs? Yes, great. Websites, have you tried with websites as an alternative product? I haven't very much, but I put a prompt here to myself to say that actually a website which I created with a friend from the University of Copenhagen, completely just out of political need, because we discovered that there are hundreds of documentaries about Palestinians available freely on the web to see. We thought that it was very important because, kind of like, you know, what can we do as film scholars to support, for example, the invisibility of Palestinians who we sympathize with. We created a website called PalestineDocs.net, which is just a portal to absolutely all documentaries that are available for free online, which you can go on, from our website, which is just a portal, nothing else, and click. So we used our knowledge, this is an example where we used our knowledge of which films are there, to create an absolutely simple website. It is a website which has now been up for 3 years and every day has about 1,000 unique hits traffic. I mean, I have, like, you know, if I mess for impact, something which has taken me very little time to do and takes me no time to maintain, actually I can demonstrate that there is impact, but you never know with what you can impact. And then, just for you guys, here is, like, you know, obviously I have done extensive work on film festivals and on festivals in general. My work is in film. Can we academics get more engaged with this kind of cultural events? So I understand who is involved in any festivals. Yes. So let's be involved with festivals, because the festivals are the spaces of encounter. The main aspect is the aspect of conviviality, like, you know, people, liveness, like, you know, people coming together for the festival. The street culture, celebrating heritage, as you were saying. I was made to think about a festival in Italy which is for busking, like, you know, for street musicians. This is in Ferrara. But of course, if I just start scrutinizing what is the festival culture around the Mediterranean, certainly, I can give several talks, perhaps, about these numerous festivals. Just to mention the huge festival in Avignon, which is probably the most important one for theater. Of course, the Mediterranean is home of the Cannes Film Festival, among many others too. But at the same time, as I have spent time studying specifically the culture of North Africa film festivals, I have to say that we in Europe live with a very wrong idea that the film festivals is a European or Western thing, that the oldest festivals are in the West. It is not true. I can speak of a number of festivals that we have done in one of my books, which is about film festivals in the Middle East. We showed some of the some of very respected and old festivals are actually based in North Africa, like this Katagi Film Festival, which has been in existence since the 1950s, or the Cairo Film Festival, which is one of the biggest and A-list festivals. So probably new dimensions for our studies are there. And here I'm displaying myself visiting the 10,000 Buddhas monastery in Hong Kong last week, which is a good picture to show me as the privileged outsider. So watching across borders makes me watch the material from Turkey, and I know Turkish cinema extremely well. It's true that some Turkish films I have seen without proper translation. Some films I have sat with a doctoral student who has translated everything for me. Some films have had no translation, but still enables me to make pronouncements about these things. Again, to encourage this privileged outsider, like, you know, daring move into certain territory, I have found that the insiders to certain situation are being helped when you come as an outsider and share your observations in a fair manner. It just happened to me the other day. We had a seminar about the Busan International Film Festival and, like, you know, various other film festivals in Korea, which of course I'm not specialist on, and I'm an outsider to this situation, but I see how by sharing what I know about the festival, what I think about it, what I observe, actually stimulates the insiders to make more pronouncements and kind of furthers their research. So it is a dialogic research which encourages community development and dialogue, this is what I propagate for. So thank you very much for coming on Saturday morning. Yes.